what makes Brian a legitimate instructor for this is not only does he have hundreds of hours of instruction himself, but because he's been doing it for 15 years, he's got tens of thousands of hours implementing it. So, Brian, take it away.
Thank you very much, Ole. That's kind of a tough introduction to live up to, so let's see what I can do. I'll reinforce what Ole said. Unfortunately, in the cooperative environment we have, this, I haven't made a terribly interactive presentation. It's fairly lecture-like, which can be sort of mind-numbing, and I'll just admit to that right now. So counting on you guys to jump in with questions whenever you want. Break it up a little bit when I start to drone on about things, all right? I guess first off, how many people here do some form of project management in their co-ops, either through their jobs or through the board or whatever? So we got quite a bit of exposure in here, so that's good to see. That's kind of what I'm going to cover today, just a quick overview, give a little introduction to our company so you get a context for why we put these project management tools together. Talk some about project management basics, the different phases and tools that the projects go through, and most importantly, getting started with using project management in a worker cooperative, in a typical, classic style of a functional organization. Project management is fairly straightforward because of the tiers of management, but in a cooperative, it might not be so clear. So we have some things to talk about there. And we'll take some questions, of course. So we concept, design, and build custom automated machines. We have a spread of predominantly mechanical engineering, but also controls engineering, which is what Ole does. And then we have technicians that build the machines and some small amount of administration. We've been around since 1980. I think it started as actually a partnership with four, and then 1982 changed to the co-op format. So we've been a co-op for 33 years. So what kind of industries do we serve? Medical device and consumables, anything from pacemakers to stuff for cataract surgery. Consumer products, things you might see in stores like those scrumptious Pringles or nooks for your child to chew on, toothbrushes. Light industrial products, casters, box fans, all kinds of automotive work, oil filter adapters. We don't pigeonhole ourselves into any one particular industry. We keep ourselves very diverse. So we don't invent any of these products. Our customer invents these products. We build an automated machine that creates those products for them. And then we build it, we test it, we run it off our floor, we ship it to their facility, and then we train their workers on how to run the machines. Most of our projects take 45 to 60 weeks. Do material handling, assembly, web converting, other custom processes, and integration of large systems. So a little history on our project management. A lot of good engineers, really good product. We make fantastic machines. Probably 80% of our business is not generated through sales going out looking for work, but just the phone ringing of customers who have passed purchase machines. So we don't have to have a huge sales effort because people like our product. We stand behind it, and I think being a cooperative, of course, lends itself very well to that. Our customers understanding the importance that the projects have to us, right? Because we're all owners, and this is our lives, and we want it to be good. And that really came across well. However, really struggled a lot with meeting schedules, continually late, continually informing our customers very late in the game that the delays were occurring. So not weeks or months ahead of time, but days ahead of time when they're expecting to come and see a performance run, saying, we think we're still 12 weeks away. And very, very frustrating to our customers. We had done some polling or some questions of our customers, like what do we do well, what do we not do well. We routinely heard, you guys make great, great products. You're horrible project managers. And I went to the board of directors at that point, and I said, hey, it's like, you know, managing these projects is not something new to the world. This is not a novel concept. It's done all the time. You know, we should form a committee, and we should roll up our sleeves and dig into this and figure out how to fix this. So I led an ad hoc committee, and we started out by just doing some online research, getting some books, and then I had decided to just Google some training, and turns out that some of the highest rated project manager training in the country was right at the UW-Madison at their Executive Education Center, which is just, you know, 10 miles from our plant. So signed up for that, got a couple of us signed up, and went through it. And then we started coming back to the committee and working on, you know, how do we take this information we learned, how do we integrate it into our structure here. So we created a project management framework for that. And then, you know, these projects we do, at ISMIS, we are what in the project management world would be termed as a 100% projectized environment, which means, you know, we have no standard product, we have no daily operations, we live project to project, and if we don't have a project, we close the doors and go home, because there's nothing else to do, okay? So the primary need for this was making sure we have those projects under control for our customers, because that's our livelihood. However, we started using these principles at the board level for internal projects as well. And so that's probably, for a lot of you here today, it might be more applicable if you're not working on, you know, projects for customers. Well, what about projects that you get assigned by your board of directors, or you take for approval to your board? So throughout this, keep that in mind as we go through this presentation, that these projects could be external or internal, okay? This is a quick look at what our framework looks like. Don't expect you to read that, don't worry. But we'll maybe touch on this later if we have time at the end, and I'll show it in a little more detail.
Project management, how exactly do you define that? Like, at the beginning, you're like, if you're in project management, raise your hand, and I'm like, I think I am, but I don't really specifically understand what that term is.
That's a perfect segue, because you know, and I didn't even plan about there to ask my question. It worked out really good. All right, so what we're going to cover in the project management basics is, okay, exactly what you just asked, the project definition. Okay, what does that mean to be a project? Why do projects fail? We'll talk a little bit about the what we call pain curve in project management, the triple constraint principle, and this next one's a mouthful, progressive elaboration versus scope creep, which is kind of an important one. Project definition. So the project management, slow down for you. The Project Management Institute would.
Are you guys sharing this PowerPoint?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, we've already sent it to the conference, and they'll be posting it.
Yeah, and if you send me an email, my email's up on the board. I'll email it directly to you. The Project Management Institute defines a project as a temporary endeavor undertaken to create a unique product, service, or result. And so what that means is if you are implementing a new piece of software at your company, okay, the choosing of that software, the implementation of that software, getting people up and going on it, would be considered a project, because you, at the end of the day, once the people were trained, it was up and running, you'd say, it's complete. If you were to perform an annual review on the performance of that software, if it's met expectations, that would not be a project. Okay, that's operations. So projects are things that have a very definable end. Say, if we're setting out to do this goal, once we have met that goal, it's over. It's done, okay? It doesn't continue. So why do projects fail? Projects usually fail due to a failure to plan or maintain control during execution. Okay, so those, when they quiz project managers on why projects fail, planning is a huge, huge thing, and then the control is a huge thing. I'll catch up. The pain curve of project management. There's always pain, right? I'm not here to lie. It's never that easy, otherwise it wouldn't be worth doing, right? So, using project management, usually right at the onset of a project, you have a lot of work to do, okay? There's a lot of planning, a lot of information that you need to get. There's lots of meetings. And the time you spend doing that up front many times doesn't feel like you're necessarily going very far or very fast or getting a lot done. However, as the project progresses, things get easier and easier. The opposite is true, and to a more exponential degree, if you decide not to do those things and then sort of at the end, things become very, very difficult. So that's what this curve generally shows, is it's way easier to spend the time thinking things through, planning things correctly in the early stages than to wait, and so it's very difficult to manage. The triple constraint principle of project management. This one is very, very important, basic to understand. So you can imagine these three points connected. And if you tug one in any direction, how it affects the other. So if someone comes to you and says, we need to take some time out of this project, the answer you give back is, do we want to cut cost, or do we want to increase cost or decrease scope? Okay, because that is your solution to cutting out time. You can't do it for free. If you want to cut costs out, are you going to allot more time to get it done, or are you going to cut scope? We want to increase scope in this project. We want to add features. We need to do more work. Well, are you going to give us more time? Are we going to get more money, or both? Okay, so this is a very important context to always think of things in during a project, is that you cannot, you know, increase or decrease time, cost, or scope of a project without affecting the others. So it's very important to understand as you're looking at projects, what's the most important thing. So if you're working with your board of directors and you have this idea for this project, a lot of times it's good to have thought this through even at the project approval phase and say, hey, if the most important thing is that this thing stays in budget, then I need flexibility to maybe take more time or maybe cut some features out. Okay, and sort of understand that going in. I guess the interpreters will have a fun time with this one. Progressive elaboration is defined as continuously improving and detailing a plan as more detailed and specific information and more accurate estimates become available as the project progresses, and thereby producing more accurate and complete plans that result from the successive iterations of the planning process. Woo. So that's a mouthful. That's straight out of PMBOK, the project management's body of knowledge. And what it's saying is that you know, learning from the project as it's progressing is okay. learning on the fly, things, you get more information, information you didn't have at the start. So changing your plan, modifying the plan as you go, as an iterative process, is completely acceptable. That is, shouldn't be confused with the term scope creep, which is a very typical problem in project management these days. And that is adding features and functionality, or project scope, without addressing the effects on time, costs, and resources, or without customer approval. So, perhaps you've been involved in a project at your co-op to do something, and 4 months into the project, suddenly someone's added a whole bunch of features, added scope, and never gotten back and asked for the board to do those things, or has ever consulted with others. This is something that a good project manager is always on top of, because a good project manager will always know whether the work being done is working toward completing the scope and not more than the scope of the project. The project phases and tools. So these are the general phases of a project. You initiate, you plan, you execute, you monitor and control, and then you close. These are defined by the Project Management Institute. There is a first one on top of this list that we don't use called conceptualizing. Since our projects come to us from our customers, so we don't do that conceptualization phase. So I won't cover that in detail. Initiating a project. So this is where I'll show you the first sort of tool that I have for you to use, and I think is one of the most helpful things I'll probably give you today. And that's called a project charter. Okay? And a project charter is what sort of gives alignment to everyone that's, you know, making this decision to move forward with this project of what you're doing. You know, what are you going to spend? What kind of work are you going to get done? What does done look like? How are you going to know it's done? Right? How do you know if you ever got out, you know, did you achieve what you meant to achieve? So all those things are defined in this document, so that throughout the process, you can always go back and say, wait a second, people, I think we're getting off course. What did we decide to do when we all looked at each other and said we're moving forward with this project? Okay? And so this is a document that's usually put together by the committee or whoever you're assigning to do something like that. So maybe something nice here. Give me an example of a project or something you did for your co-op. Either you took to the board of directors and got approval to do, or you were assigned by the board of directors to pull off. They got an example. Yeah.
We just decided to implement a CRM software.
Okay.
Can you repeat that, please?
Implement a CRM software. It's a customer relationships management software. Salesforce.
Okay. So how did that come to your board? Did one person propose it, or a group, or?
I honestly don't know, because that was before I started.
Okay. So was that task assigned to you or to someone you or else in the co-op?
It was a committee.
It was a committee, okay. So the committee who was given this task by the board, when they were given this, did the board have a very well-defined, specific thing of, you know, here's exactly what this thing is, and here's what it's going to do, and here's how much you can spend, or was it more like go figure it out?
I think it was more like go figure it out.
Okay.
I wouldn't know.
All right. So this would be a good case for using this project charter then, where you have a general direction, but you don't have all the specifics. As part of that initiating process, that's when a project manager will get assigned, and that's when you'll get the approval to start using resources and spending money. Okay. I do have this as a hard copy handout you can pick up afterward, and it'll also be online, or if you email me, I'll send it to you. But this is just got, it's probably tough to read, but you know, who's involved in the project team, what the problem statement is, what is the description of your project, who are the stakeholders? You probably hear that term a lot more these days. That's a project management term for, you know, who's going to be affected by this project. Very important to understand when we're taking a project is who is affected by it. In the planning phase, you need to develop a schedule. There are four things needed to create a schedule plan. You need work elements, and if you've ever used like Microsoft Project software or other Gantt chart software, they will commonly refer to those as tasks. You need the estimated effort and duration for those items. Does anyone know the difference between effort and duration? Does anyone want to take a stab at that? Yes.
The effort is how much work goes into it, or how hard it is, or complex it is, and then duration is how much long time you can
see. Yeah, so that's
like database updating might be a low effort because you don't have mindless, but it might take you 15 hours. And then something that might take only an hour is actually high effort because it's a complex challenge to figure out if you don't know what the task is.
Okay, that's a good way of looking at it. I'll, you know, it's, you have the right thing with the effort is the hours it takes, and that's the key thing is in a project, in order to schedule properly, you need to understand if applying more resource to something causes its duration to shrink, okay? Is it effort-based or is it purely a set duration? So let's say I'm gonna build a new fence out here. I go to order the materials. If I assign two people to order those materials, do you think the materials get here much faster? No. If the materials get here and I assign two people instead of one to put the fence up, does it get done faster?
Yeah.
All right, so it gets done faster. Right, so anytime you look at scheduling, you have to understand what is affected by applying to and what is affected by, it's just a set time. As a rule of thumb, people will say like, well, assigning two people to something doesn't make it go twice as fast. In fact, studies have shown that you lose about 15% every time you add a person. So it's just you have meetings, inefficiencies, communications, things get added, so. If you're figuring 100 hours for one person to do something, it'll take 115 hours for two people, and 122, whatever it is, and a half hour for three people, and so on.
We have in my company, in my co-op, we have a composting co-op, and here in Boston, we collect the wasting food for the business, like college, restaurant, and supermarket. And because we started operation on October 14 last year, and we was building the project for about 3 years, we going through something like that because we went through a DPO, the therapeutic offering, to try to have a working capital. And we just been in now on July 9. For the last time, we had to use a barrel. We ordered to the company a 480-pound barrel. And we use a box truck. What this mean? That we needed two men to work in the box truck. So it has to be a box truck with lead gate, and they have to paint, take it the barrel, put inside to the same when they going over there to the composting plant. So we need a truck, a special truck, that one person can do the job. Because if we have a truck that can take the barrel and put it up, the same won't happen when the truck going to the plant, the composting, the truck going to. So only one person can do the job. And now we use, we have a high labor cost because we use two persons. And we use it a lot more time because we don't have the right vehicle to do the job. So I think so. That when you're talking, apply exactly. We thinking that as soon as we have the right vehicle, we're going to maybe 50% of the cost. Mm-hmm. That's what we believe in.
Okay. Did everybody get that, for example?
The third thing you need to create a schedule plan are logical dependencies. You have to understand what is affecting what. So to what level of completion do I have to have one task in order to begin another? Are they unrelated? Do I have to have one 100% complete? If you were building a house, you would have to have the footings poured before you started framing. Okay, it just have to be completely done. It couldn't be half done, couldn't be started at the same time. It's gotta be complete. There's other things that you could do, plumbing and wiring at exactly the same time. You could start either one before the other or at the same time. So things like that you have to consider when you're creating a schedule. And then the resource assignments, of course, who's gonna do the work? Are they available? And then internally, how are those resources being assigned? And this is a critical thing in most environments because I would say the majority of time the people doing project work are not solely assigned to that project work. Okay, they have other responsibilities. So you may have a functional job where you are doing a normal job that you're paid to do every day as an employee or member of the co-op. And then on top of that, you may be assigned this project to, I'm sorry, what was your name again?
John.
To implement the software, while that might not be the only thing that committee is assigned to, they probably have normal day-to-day work, right? So they need to manage that time appropriately. So what time is actually going to be committed by these resources? For project management software, you can build a Gantt chart, set a baseline, identify a critical path. Those are all helpful things. As part of the planning phase, you're also identifying and resolving issues with scope, schedule, and cost. That's what a typical Gantt chart looks like. I don't expect you to read it. It's just an example.
What this does show, though, is what Brian was talking about, where you're going to build a house, you have to have the foundation done first, and then other things can start from that. There are certain things here you can see have to be finished before other things can begin.
The red line is identifying the critical path through the project, which the critical path is any increase to time on that line pushes the end date of the project. Okay, so everything shown in blue means there's some amount of time that could be added without affecting the end date.
It's like a timeline at the top there.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So it's a very powerful software. If you run a lot of projects, it's worth it.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask. Is there any particular software that you recommend? I mean, I'm in a startup for a co-op, a food co-op. Because we're bootstrapping it at this point, just created that on an Excel spreadsheet with dependencies. So it's, even though it doesn't have those, but it's not really in the style of a Gantt chart, it has the same information saying this is the objective, these are sub-components of that,
right.
The dependencies of one thing depend on another, so if that's not at 100%, the next thing can't start, or
right.
Whatever it may be. So sounds like basically the same thing, but free. So I don't know.
Correct. So yeah, there's great ways of that of modifying spreadsheets to do that kind of work, which is great if you can do it. You know, there's more tools available, and something like this is Microsoft Project. There are several others out there that I'm not as familiar with. But you know, if you're just sort of starting to dabble in project management, or especially if you don't have hundreds of tasks, I wouldn't recommend rushing out and spending a bunch of money on software. If you felt like it and learning it, I don't know, I never really researched free tools that might be out there. I'm sure there's probably some. I don't know what project, it's probably like a $700 or $800 package or something for this software.
The last time we made this presentation, somebody said there was an open office, a free tool out there. And I did some research, I was never able to come up with it, so I don't know if anybody ever finds it, let us know. But what the function that you're doing is exactly what he's describing. The tool that you're using just probably isn't as expansive, so you're doing it right.
I have suggestions as well, but one thing that's not necessarily project management, like doing this timeline things, but doing online communication and distributing tasks and things like that, that there's a bunch of online tools for, are things like Productive and Trello, it's like, and there's a bunch of other ones too, that I have a list of, if you want to send it out.
To dovetail off that teamwork. Is the one that teamwork, I don't know, but it does that. It does the Gantt charts too.
Oh, okay.
Did everybody hear that? Teamwork does something very similar.
To write the list, there is one called Wrike, WRIKE.com, and it is free for 5 users, so like I can hear this that there are small teams.
Are you supposed to approach that? Because what we do is we just give them deadlines.
Yep.
Is that like a good approach?
Yeah, it's certainly a mini multi-layered question. I mean, as a project manager, I think you use what you have at your disposal to influence getting that work done. So within your own organization, you might not have much power, and you have to use your charisma and
charm
to get things done. If you're paying for an outside vendor that's doing a piece of work for you, and you're withholding, say, payment of that work being done until it's complete, you can lean on them financially, things like that. So you really, it's a toolbox, and you gotta pull the tool up. It's right for the job. So it's not easy to give you a direct answer on that one. But certainly, with internally, I mean, it's best to if people are falling behind, to understand where their issues are, so you're not just like, hey, I need this done, get it done. It's just like, okay, well, we were supposed to have this done today. And you don't have it yet, so let's see where you're at, and okay, what's holding you up? What's preventing you from getting this done? Okay, are you assigned to too many things? If I get you some additional resource to unload some of that responsibility, would that allow you to focus on this some more and get it done? So, that is certainly a skill that's learned over years of trial and error. And I've had plenty of errors on how to do it the wrong way, so and you'll find that out a little bit as you start doing it. But for the most part, I mean, communication is the biggest thing. Don't be a fist pounder and say you got to have it done or else. I mean, you need to understand why that work's not getting done and see it from their perspective, so you can help get to where you need to be.
When you're planning a schedule, are you planning it based on how long you think it will take, the ideal timeline, or the longest possible timeline that would still be acceptable for a project?
So, usually what you want to be realistic in every schedule, because if you start off with something very unrealistic, that being too something that could never get done in that amount of time, or something that's so obviously much longer than it should ever take, that'll be fairly obvious to most people. And so they won't really get buy-in on the project. And so to get to how long that project's really gonna take, you need to understand those work elements, and then you need to go to the people doing that work, and you need to ask them, how long is this gonna take? And in doing that, you're gonna get a lot of different responses depending on the type of individual. So some individuals are gonna be like, oh, that's gonna take me 3 months to get that done. You know, and other people will be like, I'll have it done next week, and it's the same amount of work. So one of the tools that project management use to help get around that is, I think it's called the PERT method, Progressive Evaluation Review Technique. And this is what it's based off of. Who drives at least 45 minutes or more to work in a day? Like, you have to drive in a car at least 45 minutes? Okay. So, what, on an average day, how long does it take you to drive to work?
Well, I live in the field, so it's where my clients are. That's huge town right now.
Okay. Someone's got like a set drive where they're, is there someone who's just like in a car every day for, okay. So how long does it normally take you?
About an hour.
About an hour? Yeah. Okay. What's the fastest you've ever done it?
55 minutes.
55 minutes.
Light traffic.
All right. So what's the longest it's ever taken you?
Two and a half hours.
Right. So this is what's true in projects as well. Your ability to get something done faster, okay, is very small. The ability for it to go to the other direction. Okay? So,
perfect example.
So much of project management is just statistics. You'll never hit the right task that says this is the one that's going to cause me the trouble, or this is the one. But what you can do is take an average. And so that same question that I just posed, you can pose to someone else and say, how long is it going to take you to get this done on average? Well, what's the fastest you would get it done? Well, worst case scenario, you're overloaded. How long is that really going to take? I give you a number. Rule of thumb is you add the first number, the fastest they've ever done it. You add four times the average number. You add one time the highest number, and divide by six. I'm not making this up.
Say that again.
One times fastest, four times average, one times slowest, divide by six. So this, while individually will not protect you against one blowing up, if you apply it across everything, statistically speaking, you end up with an average at the end of many tasks throughout a project. So that would be generally how. Now, once you've been in your business environment long enough and you've been through enough projects, a lot of times you don't have to ask those questions because now you just know. So now, unless it's a very specific thing that I haven't dealt with before, I can usually just generate those numbers without talking to people because I've been doing it for 15 years and I just, I know what it takes. But until you develop that instinct, this is a good way to think about it.
Excuse me. Mm-hmm. Just one more time. One time's fastest, four times
average,
and
one time slowest.
Okay.
Divided by six. Executing phase is completing the project work. That's where you spend most of the money, your time. So you're coordinating your resources and you're managing your stakeholder expectations. Monitor controlling phase, that's where you're going to update your project issues log, monitor project performance, you're going to find out, are you bleeding money too fast, is it taking way too long to get done? So a good important note of monitoring project performance is in completing a project from where it's at today, is how much money or time you have spent on that project relevant on whether or not you continue. Do you believe that at a point in a project, any given point, whether it's 10% done or 90% done, okay, where that project is at today, whether or not you carry that project forward, is how much you have already spent in time and money, does that matter?
No.
Correct, it does not. That's a good thing to keep in mind, because a lot of people will say, well, we've already spent this much. Completely irrelevant. The only thing that matters is from today, this day forward, will the time and money we spend be worth it? Okay? So sunk costs are not important going forward. They're already under the bridge.
Can you elaborate on how you see the executing phase and the monitoring and controlling phase being discrete? Because it seems like they would overlap. I'm sorry. Could you elaborate on how the executing phase and the monitoring phase would be discrete from each other? Because I see them overlapping a lot.
They do. And I probably should have explained that better. These phases, specifically, the executing and monitor controlling phases are very iterative, so they're not, it's not one before the other. They're taking place at the same time and in iterations. So they are, it's, they separate them as far as duties, but they are taking place concurrently. Does that make sense?
Right here, Brian.
Sorry. Yes?
I totally understand the sunk cost thing, but I wanted to ask about one particular situation, or maybe not that particular, but something that might put a challenge to that.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say you're 90% done with the project, and it's very challenging, and for some reason or other, people are proposing dropping it, and you say that sunk costs don't matter. But if you compare that, say, with a whole new project, the amount of time and effort that you have to put in to start a whole new project as opposed to just that last 10% to finish, wouldn't that necessarily make, you know, the time and effort that you've already put in relevant to what the payoff is going
to
be?
You know, if it's something you have to do, yes, because you're following up with saying that you are going to have to do something. So the costs of the other method you're talking about would be completely relevant in that regard. But what if you just did nothing? What if you just packed up and went home? Said, this is no longer a project, we're done.
Well, then you'd have to be like, you're going to have to find another project. You have to bring more work in. Like, you either do one project or another project, right?
Well, in our customers' work, we don't have that choice because we're contractually obligated to finish it. But in a project, let's say, like here's a good example of one that I dropped. I was interested in trying to make the company fairly paperless. It just blew my mind at the reams and reams of paper we print off. And I'm like, this is like a computer age, and we're just chopping down trees and chucking stuff in the garbage. Just drive me bananas. So I was where I said, I want to have a little committee. I want to figure out how do we go paperless? How do we communicate with our customers, our vendors, everything else in such a way that we don't have to print all this stuff all the time? And after working on it for over a year, I just abandoned the effort because our systems were just too non-integrated and the technology wasn't there for us to, you know, to get there. There's too many people working manually in a manufacturing environment where they want a hard copy of the prints. They still want to have that traveling with the part to the next place. They don't want to have to find a PDF somewhere on a computer. So we just you know, said that we're done, project's over, you know, it's not going to be worth pursuing anymore. So that would be an example of one where just walk away.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense.
So even though we spent a year of effort and, you know, probably 100 hours of people's time and effort just trying to figure out how to do it, we just got nothing out of it, just.
Yeah. Okay.
If technology ever changes and our customers get up to date, that project can come back up.
Oh, yeah.
But,
and so as we get later in the presentation here, we talk about lessons learned and how we collect those in the best practice library. So that's where we collect those things for future in case we can bring it back. This is just a typical look at a issues log. I've got hard copies up here for you to take, and also electronically, it's much more useful electronically. But this is the kind of tool I use to just keep track of issues on the project and what's happening with them. Closing a project, your team and your stakeholders, it's always good to have a closeout review, understand how that project went, to gather some lessons learned, and to maintain a best practice library. So that's a way to people to access information from these projects you've been doing and get better at a more efficient. If you're new to this, this is one of those things I would encourage you to find a very simple way to do. It could be as simple as a form as this, is all you use. Just what it's called, who wrote it, the date they wrote it, if it was revised, and just a very just simple description or instruction. Just keep a library of things like, you know, we tried to implement this software. We found out that, you know, we could not, you know, the only way to make it work with the sales group was to do this, this, and this, and just any of those kind of little things that if 5-10 years later, you could go back and pull upon a way to capture those things that's important. It's also good to give some feedback to other team members. Did they meet expectations, you know, were there struggles? And sometimes that's hard to do with other individuals, but it is important for us to learn and grow, so I encourage that as well.
Question.
Yeah.
Where does that best practices live, and like how do you reference it?
I mean, most people would just put it on a network, like in a common location, something searchable. You know, we keep it up on a SharePoint, and then you know, through there you can just do a text field search, so any documents containing that text will pop up in that search. Say like, okay, software implementation, enter, and just see what, you know, comes up. Because trying to spend a lot of time like highly categorizing them just makes it like possible to find anything, you know, never look at it. So usually having some way that's text searchable, then, you know, we just mostly drop in a single folder.
About how much time and effort are you putting into going back to those best practices before starting the next chart?
It really depends on the project. I would say, you know, I would say with like work projects, for our customers, it's a little bit more because there's some pretty good detailed engineering information that's a little more intensive to sometimes look through, like how we, you know, we have a, you know, probably a 20-page document on how to assemble a machining slide. You know, that's, you know, really good technical information, but it takes time to sift through. But something like, you know, like I put together for the example of the paperless, you know, I don't know, smaller projects like that, you only spend 10 minutes or something, 15 minutes just seeing if there's anything relevant in there.
How the project can be away?
Excuse me?
How you make a question with a project? How? You put it, you have a destroyed. And how do you about?
Well, we usually work in the project team meetings, we'll decide those things. You mean like if we're taking the right direction, if we need to change course, or
many times you hear in the government, you hear in many business that they made this project and they put a lot of money. And after 1 year, that's gone and nothing happened because the project was wrong. It doesn't work. So my question is, who made evaluation? And if you make the project, we want to make the evaluation to see is this going to be realistic, is this going to be right, this is the right thing that, this is the right project that we have. Because we're going to thinking, this is the project, no, this is perfect, this is going to work, this is 100% correct, but maybe not. Who tell me, yeah, this is the right thing, and we're going in the right direction? Who tell me that? How I can find out? That's my question.
So for us, you know, this would be an important question for internal projects. Okay, our external projects, you know, we sell, we have to commit the fulfill a contract, and whether it's right or not, or how much it costs us, we're legally obligated to finish it and complete it, no matter how it turns out. But internal projects, we assign either project manager individuals, or in most cases a committee that'll have a head. Okay, and then at our monthly board meetings, it's on the minutes, and so they have to update their progress, okay, and say how things are going. And so at any point, month to month, the board could decide to either tell them to change direction or to kill it based on reports they're getting back. Mm-hmm. So the board of directors.
That's fair. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
So if you're contractually obligated to complete the projects that you take on, you must vet them very carefully beforehand. So how do you do that?
I would like to believe we do that.
So you don't get stuck.
I've had a couple times that I've sat across our sales manager's desk and shook my head and be like, what did we do? for the most part, I mean, we pull upon experience and have to tread very carefully on those, because there's a lot online. Yeah, it can be very frustrating when, I had a project several years ago that, I mean, after I looked at the terms and what we had to do, and I was like, you know, no way, that's okay. There's just no way I'm getting this done within money or even close to it at the time. So I was back on my heels right off the bat. You do what you can, but yeah, I was committed to customer in 30 weeks. I did it in 52, which I thought was amazing. I looked at it and thought it was 60. So that happens. But then that's when you have those conversations, those closeout meetings. Say, all right, sales, let's vet this out a little bit more next time, and maybe come and get some of our opinions for. But that's, very, very, very important. And understanding the metrics, because they change. I mean, month to month, year to year, you know, the costs change, you know, everything changes. So it's keeping your, whatever metrics you're using to cost things have to stay calibrated to today's environment. You know, it's a constant challenge.
I have a question related to that about planning. Because so much of the planning takes time in itself and gives you a better idea of the length and therefore what you should cost. And we also work with clients and then are giving them a proposal. Mm-hmm. So how much of that are you doing in advance of preparing a proposal, and then what do you do when you underestimated and you start doing the work once you are in the contract and realize that your contract is bigger but you didn't have that information? Because you, like, where's your balance in terms of doing unpaid planning to propose something versus?
Yeah, it will depend on project size, and it'll depend on our past experience with that customer. I would say probably typically spend about 40 to 60 hours of our own investment on a typical proposal before we look for money from the customer.
Many times when we're writing a quote, we'll write a functional spec, which is a document that describes what we're going to do and how we're going to do it. And it's based on information that they've given us. Maybe they've got two pieces that need to be put together, and they tell us that it takes 50 pounds of force to put it together. And when we build a machine to do it, we find out that it takes 5,000 pounds of force to do it. Then we have something we can go back with and say, listen, this is outside the spec that you told us, and this is what we said we were going to do, and now it's going to cost you more money if you want us to do it. So anytime there's a risk involved, you want to be make sure that it's documented and that in the project charter, I can't think of the title of the category, but there's an area for defining what your risks are, what you don't know. So you definitely want buy-in. Ed?
Since you all have implemented these project management practices, what has been the result in terms of the outcome of your relationship to your customers around job completion, timely job completion?
It's gotten way, way better. it's turned, you know, what was once our weaknesses into one of our strengths. So now, you know, we've had lots of customer feedback that we're doing this better than any of our competition. So it's been a pretty remarkable transformation, and definitely a success story within our business to change the culture to people to take on these things. And part of it's applying the right personnel. In our environment in the past, a lot of times the best engineer just got promoted to project manager, but what you find out is that there's some brilliant, brilliant engineers that just cannot manage anything. You know, they're just great, great technical resources, but they just don't handle these sorts of details very well because it's just not, you know, part of their core skill set. And they could be trained and they could get better at it, but then they're not performing what they're really good at and makes them happy, you know. So a lot of project management too is understanding the different puzzle pieces you have and how they snap together to make a whole picture. And instead of just saying, well, this person's going to do this no matter what, because that's what we say that their role is, you know, it's like, so that was a big part of the process too, was learning, you know, to assign projects to people who were excited to run projects and, you know, had an inclination to learn and get educated and use these principles, and people who really just wanted to design and make things work and not be bothered with spreadsheets and Gantt charts, and just, you know, push them in that direction, and that's worked very well.
We really do feel that the combination of being a democratic workplace, being, you know, a worker cooperative along with our project management skills gives us a huge advantage over our competitors.
I want to talk with using some of them. It'll usually be the first 3, maybe 4 weeks of a project, I will be 80-90% dedicated to the to the planning of that project and most of the project management details. I'll just be turning over stones, looking for problems. I'll just fill out that issues log. I'll travel to the customer. I'll try and understand everything they know. You know, talk to their everyone, the line workers who make the parts today or similar parts, understand their culture. Because there might be things just that might be difficult to implement on a cultural basis. So that's all part of that early pain curve. It's not just, you know, making up a schedule. It's really understanding everything. You know, what are the risks? What are the backup plans? Well, what if, do we put all our eggs in this one basket, and if that fails, you know, it's going to cost us millions? Or do we have a plan B? You know, so there's a lot of elements that go to that early part of that pain curve, but it's planning, schedule, it's, you know, interaction with the customer, it's risk assessment.
Related to that, I think, so we're in the landscaping industry, so we're doing several projects at any given time. And I think we know the pain curve is there, but sometimes, like, you're so busy with the projects that are already happening,
yeah,
that it's very hard to do all the stuff on the front end that you should, that's going to make the next one,
yeah,
go better. Do you have any wisdom?
Yeah, because the thing is it's tough to break the chain, right? Because it's like you're always living in the moment of that steep
of
pain of a last
spread.
Project, right? So, yeah, it's one of those things that you have to, you know, apply some extra resource or just kind of, you know, suck it up for a little while. And sometimes, I mean, when we started doing this, I mean, it wasn't always comfortable, some of the extra hours we would put in to pull it off, you know. I know coming off details of my previous project and starting, you know, one like this, I mean, I'm not gonna kid you that it's easy because of for that reason. I mean, it can be made a lot easier if you appropriately assign, you know, extra resource to allow for that to occur. But if you have limited resources, it's not practical to bring more on. I mean, it's, yeah, it's maybe a few long weeks.
So you talked earlier about sharing the project plan files and other files on, you know, like a shared disk or SharePoint or whatever, but I was wondering if you had any tools or strategies for keeping the team engaged with the project plan? Because you can't, I mean, you can never like check on how many times somebody's built the project plan. So like how do you know, do you have any strategies for keeping your team engaged and where you are on the project?
So I use weekly meetings. So I have a team meeting once a week. We review everybody's progress, and everybody has input on that person's progress. So that's how we sort of get buy-in that the eventual, you know, machine we arrive at, everybody feels like it's theirs. It's not this individual came up with this part. It's like we all sort of bought into this the way we're doing it. So that's a critical piece, is that weekly meeting. I do that once internally with the project team, and I do it once with the customer. So I have two standing meetings every week.
And it's important to do those meetings as a team and not individually, because peer pressure is a wonderful thing.
Well, how am I doing on time?
So, we've got 15 minutes left.
All right. So this is, I guess, some key things I want to share because it's related to the doing this in a co-op, because in a normal, functional, you know, work environment, you know, people have what are called PMOs or project management offices. You know, they have a hierarchy from the CEO all the way down to, you know, this mid-level manager of we don't have that, you know. So how do we use some of these principles about that, you know, organizational structure? So talk a little bit about establishing the governance, determining the project manager authority, identifying and managing stakeholder expectations, resource issues, and best practice library. Establish governance. What group is authorized to approve variances in project scope, schedule, or cost? Very, very critical. So if you kicked off on an internal project, you think that the board of directors is giving you this authority, and then suddenly, well, we think that we need to add all this additional scope, or we think we needed to take 10 additional weeks. Who has that authority? Does the project manager just do that? Does he have a contingency? Do we have to go back to the board and ask for it? Is there a separate, you know, two or three individuals before the board that have oversight or some sort of intermediate contingency? Good to have an understanding of that for sure. What's the amount of their contingency? How far can they go? Can they spend double the cost of the project, 10% more than the cost of the project? Always got to have some level of contingency, because whether it's the amount of scope, the amount of time, or the amount of cost, almost no project ever hits three. Okay? Most projects don't hit two. All right? That's just the way life is. I mean, things happen, they come up, you learn. So understanding as those problems occur, how are they going to be addressed? What project stakeholders need to be involved based on variance? So it could be that a financial impact might be a different set of individuals than, say, a scope impact. So someone says, well, now we want all these additional features to this software. Well, is that an important piece for, if it's not going to cost much extra money, just some more people's labor and not a lot of additional hard costs? Is there certain people that can sign off on that rather than say we're going to spend another $10,000 on this? I don't have the answers for you. These are the questions you need to ask in your organizations, at your co-op, your boards. You know, have a good handle on this before you go forward. And the project manager authority, how much contingency is given to the project manager? Does that project manager, can they direct or apply new resources? Big question to ask. So you assign someone to implement a project to running out of examples here. Keep going back to your software example. So Bill was going to get all this work done. Bill's busy with his normal day-to-day work, and turns out he's got a vacation come up next week. Does the project manager have the ability to go over to Sally and say, hey, Bill's out the next 2 weeks, can't do it, can you do this work? Or does he got to get clearance for that? Okay. So what power does that project manager have to go around and find resources to work on this project? An important question to ask. Again, don't have the answer for you because every place is different how you handle this, but have the answer. Who does the project manager report to? They go right to the board of directors. Is there a committee that was assigned by the board? And then that project manager goes to the committee. Another important one. Identifying and managing stakeholder expectations. Who needs to be involved to meet project objectives? It's a good question to answer. It may seem obvious, a lot of times it's not. Because the reality is, I'm sure you've encountered this before, there are, on occasion, in cooperative environments, people who have opinions on things. And those people aren't always significantly impacted by those decisions, but they seem to still really have an opinion. So, a good project manager will learn how to shut those people down. Okay? Not easy. Those are conversations that are usually best not done in the group environment, but hold one-on-one in a conference room and just say, hey, listen, I know you love talking about this. I know you love sharing your ideas, but you know, we got 10 people out here that are significantly impacted by this project. You're not one of them, and you're talking more than any of them. So it's time to shut up, right? How is communication to stakeholders going to be managed? So it's good to have a communication plan. Is that going to be, like we talked about, a weekly meeting where everybody's going to stay informed, or are you just going to have an email chain? It's good to have that defined ahead of time so the people out there on the project aren't sort of left flapping in the breeze wondering when the next communication is coming or where it's coming from, so that they understand there's a plan in place. Hey, we're going to send out an email every Monday at noon. We're going to have bring this up on the agenda at the monthly board meeting. We are going to have a weekly meeting at this time, set that. So communication plan, always important to start a project. Resource issues, how are they going to be assigned? Okay. Do the resources understand the project commitments for schedule? That's a good question to ask. So we decided that we're going to give John all this work to put in this new software. Does he know that? And does he know that he's got to do his regular job at the same time on top of that? Well, is he going to work overtime? Is he going to offload some of his work to someone else so that he can do the project work? Okay, all the questions that need to be asked. Can the resources prioritize the demands of their functional roles and project effort? Okay, so clear communication to, hey, your priority is your functional job for this company. If your project work falls behind, that's okay. Or this project is critical to this company, the timeline is critical. If your functional job falls behind, you need to go to your manager, go to the board, get more resource, make sure they understand the priority. What do they need to be working on? Best practice library, how will lessons learned be captured? Have a method for that. How is that information going to be shared? You know, we actually do our lessons learned. We share them at a monthly meeting with the company. So we serve the second Tuesday of every month, and we just bring in a bunch of sandwiches or pizza. And then in the last month, anyone who has something learned they believe that should be moved into the best practice library, or you know, captured as a lesson learned, shares it. The group sort of agrees, like, yeah, that makes sense. You know, that's how the things you put in there. Where to go to get information or advice. Okay, another important piece. Questions?
All right, we have 10 minutes. Does anybody have questions that have popped up?
Process for evaluating the project plan itself in addition to evaluating the execution of the project?
I would say that mostly happens at the weekly meeting level. So like if I put together that plan, you know, I share it with everyone, and if people don't like it, they speak up. You know, I usually solicit those opinions as part of the process to put it together, but then once it's together, I will share that, you know, with the team. I'll say, okay, here's what I put together. Here's what I'm selling the customer, okay? They're gonna see these details, these are the dates, this is what we're committing to. And then just sort of, Ole and I are working on the same project together right now, actually. He's the controls engineer. And so in the early stages, I went to Ole and said, hey, I'm giving you, you know, power up on this date. You're gonna get the keys to the machine. You know, you're gonna get 17 weeks to make it run. You know, does that seem reasonable to you? You know, if it doesn't, you know, or what other resource? How much help are you gonna need? You know, and now as that's becoming clearer, you know, we're looking like we want to get some more help, and that's part of what I talked about earlier with the progressive elaboration. So now that we're actually assembling it and really understanding it better, what's all involved. You know, we just talked about this last week. I was like, you know, we talk resources. we need to get somebody else on board here because this is, you know, two people's not going to cut it anymore. There's just been too much stuff. So there's the initial plan, right? And then there's the progressive elaboration of always reacting to the reality of what's in front of you, even if that's not what you had in the original plan.
I was wondering about what you might be able to say or what lessons can be learned from project management to typical daily operations? Like, how do those fit together?
Can I give you an example?
Yes, please.
Brian mentioned the project charter. You know, any new project that's not directly related to what, you know, something different, we've let that grow into a committee charter. So our standing committees that are there all the time, finance, we have office tools and tech, shop tools and tech. We said, hey, this project charter works really well because it defines scope, what they're supposed to be working on, who the stakeholders are. So all our committees now, whether it's not just ad hoc committees, but all our committees, the first thing we do when we form a new one is make them fill out a project charter so they know when to start, when to stop, what their scope is. And to give you an example of why that's important, we just bought a new machine tool for our shop. Now, the shop tool and tech guys got together and said, our current machine tool is 25 years old. It's obsolete. We need to buy a new one. It's in their scope, shop tools and tech, to look for a new machine tool. It's not in their scope to find financing for it. That's our finance committee. We don't want our finance committee deciding what machine tool to buy. We want them to figure out how to pay for it. The shop tools and tech gets to decide what machine tool they need. And maybe the two committees work together, but there's a definite difference. You don't want committees jumping out of what they're supposed to be doing and doing something else. So.
Thinking back to the Gantt chart, once you identify the critical path, you put special attention on making sure that is paid attention to over and above other paths or special resources into it once you're really, really clear what that path is?
Definitely. I've never gone with some of the cheesier solutions that I've heard other project managers using. I mean, I generally go with reminders like, you know, this ball's in your court now. You know what I mean? I've heard of other people basically making a baton and then going over to that person and slamming the baton down in the desk and saying, you're running. You know, your red line is you. So. I think that's a little excessive, but if you have a friendly enough work environment where that's fun, maybe you could try that. Most people would find that really obnoxious. but it's always definitely that's where you have to spend not only attention, but when you know that you lost that, it's the communication piece, okay? So that if a robot delivery, there's a 16-week robot delivery that's critical, and you know, only can't program it or make it run until it's installed and powered up. Well, as soon as that robot manufacturer calls me up and says, you know what, it's not 16 weeks, it's now 18 weeks. Well, I know there's no getting that time back, okay? That's critical path because it is going to prevent the power up, it is going to prevent the programming. There is no way to get that 2 weeks back out. So at that point, it's now 3-4 months before that machine ships. I get a hold of the customer and I say, you know what, I'm sorry, but we are 2 weeks behind on this project now. And they never like to hear that, but it's way better to hear that 4 months ahead of time than days or weeks ahead of time. You know, that's what project management so much is about, is understanding where you're at way before you get there, not, you know, reacting after, you know, expectations on things are done.
When you're negotiating a contract with a customer, do you somehow build into the cost that you're putting them the cost of paying the person who's doing the project management? Like, how does that factor into what you're charging?
Yeah, we have to factor it in. I mean, we have to stay competitive too. So, I mean, we're bidding against, you know, other customers on every job. But we certainly, when we put our quote together, that all that admin time, the project management time, is definitely factored in.
But is it like a line item on their what they're paying for? Is it just like you're marking up the...
Correct. And there are customers that ask for a general breakdown. So if they want to do a more apples-to-apples comparison with a competitor, sometimes they will ask for that. So there are occasions where we have broken that out as a line item, not as a purchasable line item, but as a, like, here's where the money's going. That's pretty rare, though. For the most part, it's just cooked into the overall lump sum.
Are you so if you're in the early stages and don't have a board of directors to report to, who do you advise, like, who would you say the project manager should report back to?
I guess who's making the decisions for the company? Like, if you decide you're going to buy a building, I mean, who would make that decision today?
The worker owners pretty much come to a consensus at this point.
Yeah, so then that's where you would start. Is who's ever making high-level decisions, you can start from that. And then if you can find a way to make it more efficient by assigning a smaller group, and you trust those people, you know, then that's your next step. Say, okay, well, all the members decide that just these three people getting together is enough oversight without everyone getting together, right?
It's kind of hard because the project managers are the trusted small group already. But yeah.
So are all the project managers at ISMOS expected to use this methodology kind of in the same consistent way? Is there a variance in between different project managers? Like, I'm just thinking, like, different people's brains work differently, and, like, especially when you start to get to the level of which software you're using. Like, some people just, like, can't stand using X software, whereas other people are like, that's the only thing they can use. And so I'm wondering, like, where does variance come into play? How do you deal with those sort of differences?
We give quite a bit of flexibility to the individual when it comes down to, you know, details, okay? What we expect is that at a high level that the customer is completely informed as to the status of the project, that the people that have been assigned to that project are completely engaged in that project, that they understand their roles, that they understand when the work has to be done to affect the overall outcome of the schedule of the project, the level of quality that needs to be attained, the scope, you know, of that project, that everybody is together, that they're buying in on this, and that things are getting appropriately reviewed, that we understand where the costs are at. You know, so at a high level, that's what we, you know, mainly the system we put in place. The particular tools, I mean, the issues log I showed you that I use, there's probably no one else at ISMIS that has that exact same one. They probably have, you know, all use one, but different columns, different ways of organizing it, different, because, like I said, their minds work. So we don't expect consistency in the particular tools to that end, but now's a time I'll flip over to that framework. This is what we expect is adherence generally to, as stakeholders, we have our customers, we have the sales group, our management group, our project manager, controls, design team, fab and assembly team, and throughout this process, where those things are solid, those people have to be involved in that level. And where there's circles, it means their involvement needs to be considered based on circumstance. So this is sort of a roadmap of who has to be involved in what. We expect general following of this roadmap. But the particular tools they use to get there, we allow quite a bit of freedom.
I know there's a few more questions. Oh, we'll do a quick one. We're actually out of time. So, but feel free to come up to us afterwards or whatever. Go ahead.
How long do you think your project planning meeting made this shift be some of the impact of project management on the experience? So we desperately need that. People are not taking in the reality of how long it's actually taking. Yep. That is all over. And you ask this one person, is she working on
entirely depend on the size of the project, but let me give you percentages. I would say on average, to the total hours of a project, I would generally say about 10% of those would be dedicated to the management of the project. So if I have a project that has 12,000 hours into it, I'll probably end up spending 1,200 hours on management, meaning I'll probably do little else but management for that project. If I have a project that's only 3,000 hours, well, then it's probably 300 hours of my time. I'll probably be designing away and doing real engineering on the project as well. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Wow.
All right, there's evaluation forms, I guess, we're supposed to fill out up here. I don't know where they go after you turn them in. Has anybody followed up?
Registration table.
Okay, all right. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.